are the partners with this initiative called Molokai Gorilla Ogo Survey and Control Project. We have Kua. Raise your hand, Kua. Where's Brenda? Raise your hand. Okay. We have Office of Hawaiian Affairs. Stand up, Gillian. But you're not getting one, Lee. And we have the Department of Land and Natural Resources, DARS, Division of Aquatic Resources, the Nature, go ahead, just give them the ladies, give quickly. The Nature Conservancy and Kekua Aina Hanano Ho, which is my husband. Where's my husband? And Kahina Pohaku Loko Ia Lemana, please come forward. Okay, how about a big hand for our partners? Okay, I want to call on Brian Nielsen if you'd like to say a few words. Okay, all of you can sit down except the two of you.
I just want to say mahalo to the Molokai community for hosting today. Also, mahalo to all the different participants that have helped out in today's discussion. And then also a big mahalo to Colette and all her staff that have put this together. Just here to be a part of the conversation, to listen, to learn, contribute where I can, and move forward and working with all of you on this Gorilla Ogo Control Project. So mahalo.
Thank you. Aloha kakahiaka. My name is Manuel Mejia. I also want to thank the Molokai community for coming out on a Saturday to spend some time with us and learn about how to control Gorilla Ogo. The panel that Auntie Colette has assembled is a very experienced group, unfortunately, because Oahu has some serious invasive alien algae problems. So we're hoping to be able to share some of our lessons learned. I also want to thank Brian Nielsen from DLNR DAR for leading the surveys, Auntie Colette, Oha, and Kekua Aina Hanaunau Ho for having us on Molokai.
Us being here. We thank you for all our guests from Oahu visiting us. We thank you for all the partners and participation. We thank you for all our ohana, our community. We thank you for the men of the land and men of the sea, so as our women, our families, and our children. Lord, again, as we discuss, as we share our mana'o, our thoughts and our feelings, our land, our family, our community, our home, all what is important to us, besides the mountain and the sea, is us. To make this possible and to make it move in the right direction, we thank you for all participants. We thank you for all that has come. Help us now and bless us, our fellowship, our relationship, and our friendship. We thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we say, amen. Amen.
I would like to introduce Kimo Franklin. Kimo was born and raised in New Valley. He's a master gardener and he's an active member of the Mauna Loa community. And if you're not familiar with Mauna Loa, it's that bay fronting Hawaii Kai. He was one of the community leaders in the Great Huki Project and champions Malama Aina values in East Oahu. So it can be done even in urban Honolulu, where there's tremendous growth there in Hawaii Kai. So this is Kimo Franklin. At 10 a.m., we'll be Skyping in the Rapun brothers. They are iconic to all of us here because Frederick Rapun was the doctor that lived here, and most of his children was born on this island and one on Lanai. So we're very pleased that they will join us by Skype because they're using this invasive species as a means to increase the value of his soil at the Lo'i in Waihole Valley. Followed by Wally Ito and Brenda Asanchin. Can you stand too, so if they know who you are? Many of us are part of this LIMO network, which is a statewide organization, which Uncle Wally is a part-time staff, and he has so much skills with Anuinui fisheries. And when it comes to LIMO propagation, Uncle Wally is the kupuna. So welcome on Kowali. And we have Brenda Asanchin. She's part of the Fish Pond Hui Andakua. So we're also glad she'll be meeting with two practitioners today, Duki Kalipi and Zelarina Kekahuna back there, Kalipi Kekahuna. So thank you for participating. Hi'ile Kavelo just getting off the van now. She's the executive director for Pai Pai Ohe'ia, Lawa'a and Limo Gathering at Loko'ia as a restore. There's Hi'ile, and that's Michelle Kapana Baird, Kaiser High School. I cannot even begin to tell you how inspirational this woman is. She took the students at Kaiser High School and had them understand the science behind this curriculum and move not only the students but their parents to participate. You'll be able to see in the video and what they've captured that we can replicate exactly what she has done in the schools with the community. Pam Lotoa Fuji is with the Hawaii. Pam, are you here? Oh, right there, Pam. I'm sorry, you shot. Across, Pam is with the Hawaii Coral Reef Initiative. Pam has built an outdoor mentoring network between high schools and their feeder elementary schools that partners the Hawaii Coral Reef Initiative at the University of Hawaii. So we're very pleased to have all of them here today. We have the ringers of all ringers. I mean, I like to talk like that because you folks need to know how important to move people that have been doing the work, not just talking about it, but have moved the community to make the kind of changes that we need to be committed to do here. So now, where's Manuel? I'll turn this over to him. So how about a big hand for all of our people, our guest speakers that have journeyed all the way from Oahu to Molokai. And then we have Hoaka Thomas. Is Hoaka Thomas here? Okay, he'll be in the second panel.
All right, good morning, everyone. So both Kimo and I worked on this community-based project in Southeast Oahu, Manalua Bay. And we feel we have several lessons that might be applicable to South Shore Molokai because it's geologically and climate-wise, and the reef, South Shore Molokai is very similar to South Shore Oahu, Southeast Oahu. And because of the overdevelopment, overfishing, and this invasive algae problem, we've had a lot of lessons learned. And if you don't mind, we'd like to share some of it. We're hoping, we believe that the Molokai community also can tackle their Gorilla Ogo problem here. So just by way of background, this is sort of the area that Kimo and I were working in. Sort of Maunalua Bay. It's basically from Coco Head all the way to Black Point, Diamond Head. And historically, this reef ecosystem was very, very productive. Here's some old photos. This is off Pico Reef, and the fisheries were very, very abundant. In the 1950s, there was a konohiki, Manuel Pico, and they made it to Manuel Pico, but the daily catch limit back then was 30 fish, 5 squid, 5 lobsters, and no limit on crabs per day, per person. So you can imagine how abundant that reef ecosystem was. Today, it takes, you know, this is based on kind of creel surveys, it takes many, many hours to catch papio, o'io, he'e, uhu, if you're lucky, and veke. So the fisheries has really been degraded over there. It's a very interesting reef ecosystem as well because it's spring fed. So it's arid, but a lot of underwater, subwater flow. And as you can see here, this is a horse drinking off the reef. It's drinking from a spring. And Auntie Laura Thompson used to have stories when she was a little girl riding her horse back on the reef and then the horse would stop to take a drink right in the ocean. And this is what it looks like. So this is kind of to give us all a good idea of what normally is on a healthy reef. It's a mixture of hard coral, sandy areas, and also nenue grass or seagrass that's more and more endangered. And Hawaii has two kinds of seagrass, Halophila hawaiana, hawaiensis, and Halophila. So there's two kinds. But over time, the invasive algae has been overcrowding it. as well as the other native species. So this is Mount Lua Bay, very urbanized, very overdeveloped. So everything in red is an impervious surface, and there's about 60,000 people living in this area. And with the runoff, not just sediment, but also heavy metals from the streets and other pollution, it all impacts the coral reef. This is also what a normal, healthy coral reef looks like. But with all that stress, you get this fertilization of the invasive algae, and it can just choke out all the pukas where the fish live. So then you see less fish as well. So on the surface, while it may look nice, underneath, things are out of balance because of these invasive species. So you have the Acanthophora specifera, leather mudweed, the Avrinvillea, and the Gracilaria salicornia, which is what you have here, the Gorilla Ogo. So we want to prevent an alien algae-dominated ecosystem and kind of restore it back. So the way this area kind of degraded, as you can see from this 1949 aerial shot, the waters and the reef were fairly clear. You can see down to the sandy bottom. Notice also the fish pond over here is not filled, but in the 60s it was filled, it was dredged, and houses were built, but the reef was still clean. In the 70s it was still clean, 75, and then in 1987, 88, the New Year's storm dumped a lot of sediment on that reef, and it became muddy, and that made the conditions very conducive for the invasive algae to thrive. And you can see in this photograph, 2005, how thick it is. 2009, how thick it is. And then with DAR surveyed, Division of Aquatic Resources surveyed, you know, just to get a better handle on this threat. And you can see the hotspot or the epicenter for Avrinvillea was around Pico area. And so that was the strategies to tackle it where its greatest reproductive potential is, knock the population down there, and then start little community efforts all along the coast. So this is what it looks like. And then in 2007, thanks to NOAA and Eric Koh was with NOAA at the time, Malama Mauna Loa, TNC, and Pono Pacific got this grant from Congress and started this Great Huki Project, where they cleared 23 acres, 27 acres, right, of reef flat. But it all started with Kim Payton's research. It all started with this tiny little plot. And Auntie Michelle was part of this study as well. They were seeing what would it take if we cleared, restored a reef area. Let's see what grows back in there. And so what they found was that if you cleared an area, it'll give the seagrass a chance to recover and hold its ground. So this little 1 square meter area proved that it could be done. And so we wanted to see if we could bring this to scale. And a lot of the residents in Pico area also started with training from Kim Payton, Auntie Michelle, and other devoted residents of Pico Reef. It was like a garden they were tending. They were weeded every day. And so the first lesson is that maybe the impossible is possible. You know, it seems like such a daunting challenge, but with community turnout like this, they started making a dent. And that leads us to lesson number two, is that community involvement is crucial. In fact, it's vital. Many hands make light work. And Kimo will talk more about kind of the process of it. But initially, the students, as you can see here, are kind of grossed out by it because it's muddy and stuff. But after a while, they find all kinds of sea creatures in it. And then they find joy in kind of making an impact in clearing this reef. So pretty soon, high school students were coming out. Even Hawaiian Airlines was coming out for team building exercises. It's a fantastic way to mobilize volunteers and build community. So, you know, typically when we think of invasive algae, people vilify it and it's kind of a bad thing. But in this case, there's so many positive uses that came out of it, which Hi'ile will talk about, and Auntie Michelle and Auntie Pam will talk about its power to educate, but also to bring a community back together. So here you can see this one high school group, very effective. So they knocked 91% reduction. Well, they started at 91% cover of invasive algae and they knocked it down to 9%. Lesson three is starting small made big things possible. So in this picture, you will see that tiny little square on the reef that the community was doing. And then with some extra funding, they were able to mobilize more folks to do it and then started to make a bigger impact. I'll just go through these photos. So the importance of, it's kind of like building rock, you're passing the bags of heavy limu. And so that's one of the things we wanted to highlight. When you select, and Brian will go over this later, when you select your cleanup areas, it's very important to consider logistics, like access, ease of hauling out this stuff, ability to bring trucks to haul it away, and then which farmers to give this valuable fertilizer to. So Otsuji Farm in Hawaii Kai benefited from this free organic fertilizer. Here you can see the progress being made. So they started doing 10 meter by 10 meter plots. Here's another shot from the air. This is what it looked like before and after. So you could see at high tide, the fish can actually swim in. And the difference is very dramatic. It's kind of night and day. So you went from this very thickly infested reef area to the community really having monthly events and then every weekend to clearing it to this. Now it looks like a reef from the 1940s. So it's really inspiring. And it's very empowering for that neighborhood and Paiko and everyone else who cared for Mauna Loa Bay. Last point also, this is what normal marine sediment should look like. It should be made of shell fragments, sand, not kind of the chocolate brown, chocolate milk, fine silt that we normally see. So this is what happens when you remove the invasive algae, because the invasive algae traps the mud. But without that, then it can get flushed out with the big south swells. And then eventually, hopefully, the seagrass will come back. And with that, the nenue will come in, turtles will come in too. This is what they forage on. It takes the whole community to do it. They established multiple new community sites, engaged 12 schools, 3,000 volunteers for 10,000 hours. This Malama Mauna Loa received their 501c3 status, and they worked with a lot of partners. And as you saw in the pictures, visible success makes confronting more traditional threats less daunting. So from that, they could then start tackling land-based pollution, unsustainable harvesting of resources, and it also requires kind of bold community leaders. Here, Nainoa Thompson is linking the restoration of Mauna Loa Bay with the worldwide voyage. The goal is that when Hokulea comes back, Mauna Loa Bay will be a healthier place than when she left. So that's the recovery of the native species. And with that, the uhu will come back. Also, the native seagrass, the sediment also washes out. And next lesson is science plays a critical role. So monitoring the effectiveness of your efforts and then monitoring what comes back. Is it native species coming back or is it just another invasive algae coming back? So it's very important to integrate this into your cleanup efforts, get students involved with monitoring, getting science classes involved with GPS points, marking the cleared areas. Thank you. And then also, you can see the top red line is bare substrate, and after cleaning, it has remained clear. And it's been 7 years now, right? And it's been pretty clear. So with that, just want to recap the lessons. Maybe the impossible is possible, definitely. Community involvement is crucial. Starting small made big things possible. Visible success makes confronting bigger problems less daunting. And science plays a critical role. And lastly, partnership is key. There's so many fish ponds here and great community initiatives that I think if everyone banded together, you can certainly lick this problem. So I'll now hand it over to Kimo to talk about kind of the benefits of doing this kind of community restoration efforts.
Thanks, Manuel, for the overview and the kind of background on the whole, that whole project in Mauna Loa Bay. You know, I got a little story. When we, you know, Manuel kind of touched on the very beginnings out there, and it kind of showed how the whole bay or that Pico area was covered with this mudweed, which is kind of a little bit different beast than what I think you guys are dealing with over here. You guys are dealing with a gorilla ogo. We got some gorilla ogo over there, but we have this mudweed, which is this Avranvillea almodelpha, and it's just a tremendously thick, they don't call it mudweed for nothing. It's very hard to break down. It's very beefy. It chokes the reef by trapping all the sediment. And people used to look at that and just thought it was hopeless. It was just so thick out there. It was like a shag carpet. And so when we first started pulling out there, it was interesting because people would come up to us and go, oh, you know, there'd be just a small community groups at the very beginning, six people, eight people, whatever, you know, maybe just three people, four people. A lot of the some of the residents on Pico, and we'd be out there, you know, picking some of this and putting it in bags, and they thought, what are you guys doing? You guys can't eat that stuff. I got another story on that later on, but we're just trying to pull this invasively because we're trying to see what we can do to remove some of this to see if, people would just kind of look at us cross-eyed and walk away shaking their head thinking, you guys are nuts. You know, it was just so overwhelming to look at, but I think that just goes to show to prove that you can look at something really overwhelming. And if you get buy-in from the community and people come out and they get educated as to what the issues are and how what the ideas are, what the intent is maybe to improve that area, it's amazing what can pick up and happen when it kind of snowballed after a while. It just started more and more people got interested in it. And we started to engage with the different organizations in the community, the schools. And this is just one small area. This is off Pico, kind of in the Pico of Mauna Loa Bay, almost in the center. You know, Michelle and her Kaiser High School students were out there years before us, so she really was out there doing this thing, and we kind of learned from what she did. But this Pico location, Manuel touched on Mauna Loa Bay, you know, and I'm not overly familiar with the southeast coast of Molokai, but I think there's a lot of similarities climate-wise, geography-wise, you know, on that side of the island, on Oahu, we have the valleys, we have the mountain ridges that come down to the beaches. A lot of fish ponds in the old days. Unfortunately, most of the fish ponds have been transformed now. They're either covered and houses are on them. We still have Keahupua on Mauna Loa, or Kuapā fish pond, which people know as Kauai Kai Marina nowadays. It's been transformed into kind of a marina, but we still have some small fish ponds in the area, Kalauhaʻihaʻi, Kanewai fish pond, some springs, Pico Lagoon, and there's community efforts by other organizations to preserve those areas too. But this Pico location is very unique in a way, and we talk about the suburbanization of our area, highly suburbanized now in the last 50 years. During my lifetime, being brought up in that area in Niu, just seeing the changes from when I was a small kid as to what it is now. But you can still, it's amazing because it's kind of something unique for us maybe in the fact that we have a highly suburbanized area and we can still demonstrate that these kind of projects can still occur even with the vast changes that have occurred in our landscape, because the land is having, of course, as you guys all know, a tremendous impact, in our case, mostly negative impact on the ocean and the nearshore reefs. So with that being said, Pico is unique. With it's almost like a kipuka in a suburbanized area. You got the highest peak, Pu'uokona, comes down Kalapa Omana, which is a ridge, which that one ridge is kind of rare. It doesn't have any houses on it. The majority of the ridges in Mauna Loa Bay have houses on them now. It comes down, connects to several small fish ponds in that area, Kalauhaʻihaʻi, Kanewai, Pico Lagoon. Pico Lagoon is kind of the the main estuary now for Mauna Loa Bay, where in years past it was Keahupua Mauna Loa, which has been transformed into a marina. But you still have Pico Lagoon at the foot of that that Kuleo'o Valley on that ridge, going out into this Pico reef flat area where the community has been active removing this mudweed. So you can demonstrate that. You can take people out on the reef flat out there and you can point that out to them, and they may not even recognize that because they get a whole different perspective on the area when they're standing out 50 yards, 100 yards offshore from the reef flats looking in on that whole area, the lagoon, the fish ponds, the valley, the open ridge, going all the way up to the top of the mountain. So you can really draw a nice visual on that Mauka Makai connection. when we bring groups in, you know, we've had a lot of, as Manuel was mentioning, schools, community groups, churches, halaus, organizations coming in. We had to be sensitive to the residents because, as I say, suburbia, a lot of residential. So when we work in big projects and you have fairly large numbers of people coming in, you know, could be groups of 50. We've had groups of 100. I think the biggest group we had was a Kupu event where we had 200 some odd people show up in a very compact, very tight-knit little community, that Paiko area. So we really had to be sensitive to the community concern there and find out by communicating with the residents and the immediate community what their concerns were. We think we're onto something maybe good here, but we need to hear from you guys because this is your home turf. This is where you live. So we want to make sure we're not inconveniencing you or causing issues that we're not aware of, being that you're living on this area. So we had to be respectful for that, and, you know, inform them what we're doing and get buy-in from them so that hopefully they would be supportive and want to participate and just be aware of the whole project and what we were thinking. And most of the vast majority of the residents and the community there were very, very supportive. But what we do is we go in through Kuleo Beach Park instead of going through the Paiko community. Kuleo Beach Park, just maybe a quarter of a mile down east from Paiko, where we were working. And we walked the groups in from Kuleo Beach Park, the schools and so forth. We'd stage them from Kuleo Beach Park. There was parking down there. And we could walk them in, skirt them around Paiko Lagoon, walk them down the beach, take them out on the flats. In other words, kind of give them a little bit of a tour as to what they were going into as they were walking down a 10-15 minute walk down to Paiko Beach. So they would hopefully, if they weren't from the area or weren't familiar with the area, once they were exposed to that, they would be they would be a little bit more appreciative of maybe what the work they were going to do is. They'd be a little bit more familiar with the area and some of the features of it. So they would hopefully have more interest in what the issues were out there and wanting to be a part of that and be very supportive of it. But it's been tremendous. Without the community, none of this could have happened. Community engagement has been such a big, big thing. It's really been a community-driven thing. And without the community, that's what it is. It's the community. And they've really, really done a fantastic job in working that whole area. Going into the type of pooling, and I'm sorry, Manuel, I'm not even looking at the pictures, so I'm just going to let you go at that. But I think Manuel's way ahead of me here. But what we would do is basically just pool by hand. We would have bags, we would have tobbies, we would have kayaks, we would have, just having all the supplies necessary to make it an effective work day. I think that's a very important thing. If you're going to host groups, you're having community coming out, you know, safety has to be first. You want to make sure everybody has fun, but make, you know, they have to be safe. You don't want anybody going home with injuries or anything like that. So, making sure you have all the supplies, making sure you have work for them, because they come out to work, they come out to get dirty. If you're not prepared for it, then they go home feeling unfulfilled. Just trying to make sure you have everything prepared, laid out for them when they come in. The types of pools, qualitative, quantitative, we would match up the type of people coming out, small kids, older, elders, kupuna, everything in between with the type of area. Are we going to pool in a very thickly matted area? We're going to pool in a light area. If it's thickly matted, quantitative. If it's very thin, kind of selective pooling, qualitative, also being educated and respectful of the native limu if we should run across it. And then I'm running out of time here, but I just wanted to get in real briefly because I know others will elaborate more on this, is what we did with the limu. We would take this limu, even this mudweed, which isn't like Gorilla Ogo. Mudweed, Gorilla Ogo, fortunately, is actually a better fertilizer. It has potassium and some things. Mudweed, virtually nil. It has maybe some micronutrients that can be used, but we could still take it. So we would take it to the farms. We take it to Otsuji. We take it to Aloha Aino, Kamila Nui, several other farmers in the area. And they would take this and they would compost it. It would be part of an ingredient in their recipe, their compost recipe. They would mix the mudweed in with all of this stuff, plow it into their land, maybe let it sit a week, plow it again, maybe sit another week, plow it again. So they would work it in and they transform this limu into something that was beneficial for farming. But before we did that, we also wanted to make sure that the limu would be okay to use in the soil so we didn't create issues with the soil, which would be detrimental to the farmers and the growing of their produce. So I'm going to kind of wrap it up here because I think I'm almost out of time. But I did want to say, if anybody asks you, especially in regard, well, Gorilla Ogo, you know you can eat that, but the mudweed, if you were to see it, You know, it's pretty nasty looking. And if they were to ask you, well, can you eat that stuff? Because a lot of people think you can eat most of the limus and so forth. You might probably not think you can eat it, but I used to have fun just kind of looking at people and say, oh yeah, you can eat it, you can eat it. This is good stuff, this is good stuff, you can eat it. And I pause and I look at them and I go, indirectly. And I explain the whole story about how you put it in the soil, you compost it, you use it for growing your produce. The picture probably was up there already. So there you go. You can eat it. It's going into the soil. You're growing this nice produce with it. That produce was grown with some of the mudweed. And so you can eat the limu, indirectly. With that being said, thank you very much. Mahalo.
Hi, aloha. I'm not a science teacher. Actually, I'm a PE and a health teacher. And what we do is just our passion. Just like all of you are concerned about the ocean, so are we. So actually, a little bit of the history is I have the awesome job of being able to teach about sailing. And so we try to tell the students, you can't always sail. Right now you can't sail, there's no wind. So we started to take them in to develop their own native garden. And that only lasts so long with kids. Yeah, because why? Because they're the technology society. They're so smart and they get bored. So I wanted a project that would be cool, like in the water. And I wanted something that was culturally specific and culturally sensitive, because I coach paddling. So I wanted something that was in our bay, something that was fun, something that they could do and learn about. And so we actually owe our very beginnings to some of the graduate students that were under Dr. Abbott's lab. And so nice today, my professor, Pauline, can you stand? This is my professor, Pauline Chin, and I went back to school to do a master's in curriculum development. And we used our students because they were willing participants. So she introduced me to Dr. Abbott, and Dr. Abbott told her team of graduate students, Kim Payton, which you always hear the name, and Kanekoa Schultz, and Don Adams, to help us. And so they go, what do you want to do? And I go, I don't know, something fun in the ocean. Something to protect it. Something so that the kids know that when I'm not around, they'll be able to take and step into the footsteps of others. So really, you know, I'm just the conduit. I'm not the person. I'm just the paddling coach that saw an opportunity to clean Manalua Bay. And as you saw already, what looks good on the surface isn't always true below. And we see that every day at low tide. So lucky for us, this is for later, okay? We've been able to work with them and we've made a lot of mistakes. So I'm sure you wanna know what are the mistakes that we learned. So tide is very important. You don't wanna go out there at high tide and put the kids at risk. Because we did that, you know, we paddled out. We said, oh, this looks like a good site. And then we did our own triangulation. Oh, that telephone pole on the mountain. Oh, that light over there. Oh, right here, lined up with the bay and everything, because at one time we didn't have GPS. So maybe Molokai, you might want to ask some agencies to partner with you to get those things. And so really, I owe credit today to like the people who've come before me, because Dr. Abbott learned all she knew from her kupuna. And being the first Hawaiian person in Hawaii to graduate with a PhD from Stanford, right? Berkeley, oh, even better. So I just wanted to say that, and Pam wants to talk just a little bit more about today's event. While we're here in Molokai on Oahu, they're having an event.
Aloha, my name is Pam. I wanted to let you know that today in Honolulu, we are honoring Dr. Abbott with a cleanup at the Waikiki Aquarium, which we do every year to honor her memory and her birthday, which is June 20th. So this would have been our fourth year that we honor her. But today, I know that she would be really proud of us to be here to help the community of Molokai. It's awesome what you folks are doing. We're here to lend a hand. Please let us help if we can.
So what are the things that are important to me for the kids to learn first off? And they have to know the native species of limu. And then I see Uncle Herbert in the audience. You know, the kids of Molokai are so lucky. They get to see Ele'ele, while the kids in Honolulu, they don't get to see that. You know, they're lucky they get to see some manawea, which is beautiful, but, you know, they get to see the invasive algae. And that's why it's been so important for us to work and to clear. Because you can do it. It'll take time. And I don't have a large workforce. My workforce is my students who come, and they come on a Saturday. They're not coming during a school day, because then it's not service if you get to be out of class. The only time they're out of class is when they get towards the ending of the school year, where they become little mini-me's, and I step back, and then they become the teachers. And they teach the elementary school students, and they do everything that I've taught them, they teach them instead. So it's possible. You have awesome teachers here on Molokai. You have Michelle Maioho. You have Maino Ross. And then you have, look the students in the audience that are working with Colette already doing GIS mapping. So they have to learn the natives, and they have to learn it by name, and they have to learn it by sight, because that's how our kupuna did it. So the main thing is trying to teach it the way the kupuna did. And so I had to go back and learn myself. So with the help of these people, we went on the beach, and then we picked up pieces, and we learned to identify them. And so it's really simple. It's not complicated. It's not hard, you know. And once they learn the natives, because the natives are the scarce algae, then we brought down tarps, and we laid out all of the different algae that we removed, and right there on site they had to learn the names. And it's really neat when you teach kids the scientific names, because they feel so empowered. They feel like, yeah, Gracilaria salicornia, oh yeah. Mom, today I learned about Acanthophora. We can all clear out Acanthophora. And I was just like, yeah. You know, and it has to be fun. You have to give them some kind of mnemonic device to learn, to make it worth their while. And then we always tell them, at the end of the day, you can make a difference. You just go get a little plastic bag, and when you and your family are at the beach, you just go collect, pull it out, put it in the bag, tie it in a knot, throw it in the rubbish can, because that's one bag less of algae out there. So they learn the natives first. They learn how to identify the invasives, and then they learn how to clear. So you saw Kimo and Manuel's graphic illustration of 23 acres. Sounds a lot, yeah? That's a little bit. That's like, should I hold this down? That's like right out here in your water, right there. This much. From shoreline out to like 50 meters, Manuel. Yeah. I mean, it's a large amount. But you know Manalua Bay, it's huge. It goes from Portlock all the way to Diamond Head. Yeah? Sorry. So the area that really needs to be cleared is our whole south shore of our island. But we have a good model, yeah? A good model to look at, to see how they did it. So Kimo and TNC, they took care of Paiko. And for us, we took care of Mauna Lua. And the reason why is because that's where we paddle. As I paddle for Hui Nalu Canoe Club for a long time, I'm sure the guys from Molokai Canoe Club will be happy to clean by the pier and their side. And all of you who are invested in this island, there's places that are special to your heart. So really, you know, it'll be your task, no matter where you live, to make your Ahupua'a your special place. Yeah, so that's what I want to share. And then it's really easy. Here's what we did. We took a PVC pipe, we made a 3x3 transect. Yeah. And then we put ropes in the middle to support the pipe so it doesn't bend or wobble, and holes so it sinks. And then I got 4 kids to stand up on each corner. And then I went, okay, let's do this. Let's see how long it takes for you to clear this 1 meter area. Oh, miss, easy. I go, okay, try. Let's see. So they went, and then we timed it, and it started like 10 minutes. And I said, wow, 10 minutes, take us that long. And they say, okay, okay. So it's like a race. But you see, that's my PE mentality. Make it a game. They will come. They will play. They got it down to 8 minutes. I go, wow, who can do better? They go, come on. So they start challenging each other. And really, the whole purpose of that was because Kim Payton wanted to know how long it would take to clear an area. Yeah? And so we had the kids doing science. They didn't even know it. But they loved it because they were part of a process. And then, you know, we had Kupuna come in, like Uncle Henry Chang Wong. Yeah? And he's teaching me, and whatever I learned, I was teaching them. And the stories that he told us and shared with us, and the stories that Dr. Abbott shared with us, and even Wally, and everybody, and every single one of you have Kupuna out there who have stories for you. So I really want you to embrace their stories and go collect them. But you don't have to do it. Make the kids do it. Because, yeah, we have a big fish pond over there at Kuapa. But guess what? Just like Molokai, we have our fish ponds down the row. And so one of the kids, I said, here's a project. Go home, ask your kupuna what they did when they were your age. Did they go to the beach? Did they go surfing? What did they like to do? What were their chores? And so one of my kids went home, talked to her mom, and they said, well, call up your teacher. Miss, my mom said, and I was like, mom, sometimes, you know, you just gotta swallow, right, Manuai? And so they said, my grandma passed away, but my grand aunts are still alive. Can I interview them? And I said, sure, sure. Guess what? The aunties grew up at her age at Wailupe Fish Pond. They lived there. They're Jichan. Because you know that the fish ponds were monitored by Hawaiians, right? So a judge was responsible for that kuleana of that loko'i'a. But their grandpa worked over there. And they had recalled stories of them going catching opai lolo and going catching ele ele. And they actually told me a lot about the whole community side. And then I talked to a girlfriend who does video. And we went to their house and we sat down and we videoed. And so if you want to see that video, it's on maunalua.net. My girlfriend, Annie Kirk, she went and she documented that. I'm going to let Pam.
We wanted to thank all of the partners that we work with. TNC, Manuel, Hickory that I work for, UH Botany, Dr. Celia Smith, Wally Ito, that's here from Evelimu Project, Hi'ile Covello that we work with to restore, help to restore the fish pond. My job is to help my friend here, Michelle. Any sources or resources that we can bring to the table for her to make her job easy with the kids out there is what we do. We supply her with supplies, logistics, buses, anything that she needs to further her cause in Mauna Loa Bay. We're privileged and honored to be able to work with her. I see Sarah Vasconcelos in the audience that was RGA who helped us go into the classrooms to help the kids. One of the things was to identify the natives and identified the invasives. And Sarah would come with us to the classrooms, the elementary schools and the high schools, to help the children identify what is an invasive, what it looks like, what does it taste like, and to have them draw it and to learn the scientific name so that when we took them out to do a reef walk or to do an invasive clean out at Kawaikui Beach Park, which is in our area in Manalua, these kids could know it on sight. She talked about having a tarp. That's what we do with the kids. We collect it, we put it on there, and we let them sit and go through it. Dr. Celia Smith would come and help us. So these are all the resources that are available, that were available in our community, that we can help further this. Because the number one thing for us is that we truly believe that our youth, and you have many here in the audience, they are our future leaders of tomorrow. And if we can give them the opportunity to be with Kupuna and to be with partners and to be with teachers like Michelle, then we owe it to Michelle. There's so many incredible teachers, public school, private school, charter school teachers that we have worked with over the years to help them in their cause to clean up their ahupua'a from the invasives.
So I just wanted to show my slideshow before time's up. But what I started to do was with all of our years of experience, I put together a slideshow so that the kids could further their understanding. And then luckily, Molokai's own Paul Bartram, he helped to get us some money so that we could create a book. Yeah, yeah. And so what we did was we took these and I focused on culture and science and I put in like little stories. Because kids, when they come to high school, they don't have the luxury of having Kupuna program anymore. And they love that. They love stories. So I tried to find limu and associate it with different Hawaiian icons, the queen, yeah, and the story. And find a little announcement in the newspapers, and then try to make the limu come to life in the pictures. So when we look at all of our goals, this is an educational tool. And luckily, Wally and Kua invited us to their last local I'a fish pond workshop, where they had people from statewide come in, and Oha helped to put it on too. And so here's my two favorite people, the two limu people. And so I learned a lot of things about things. And so I think what we want to leave you with is you can do it, yeah? And you have tons of people in your community. Just takes a little patience and good husbands, yeah?
Very good husbands. And we would like to honor them. Chris, who's not here with us today, and my husband Dennis, we could not do these cleanups or our events without our husbands. They're the ones that come and bring the tents, the tables, the setup, the cleanup, the garbage bags, the babysitters. They're in the water alongside the kids. They're taking pictures. They do whatever we ask them to do. So their nicknames are Honeydew.
We've been doing this for a long, long time. These different organizations have been involved in collecting the limu. And we've been using it as a soil amendment all that time. And pretty much the way we've used it has been pretty simple. We get the bags of limu, we dump them on the field, we spread them out, we till it in. And for, you know, growing taro or something like that, we make sure that we break it down on dry until it's dry, because the invasive limu can last a really long time. And one of the big fears is that we'll, you know, like get into a stream back out to the ocean and spread that way. And you definitely don't want it to go out of the watersheds too. So, but it's been a really good soil amendment. It has its high potassium, and one of the things that we use it especially for is growing Moala growing sweet potato. And it's been an excellent amendment for that. And that would be, oftentimes that's the only fertilizer that we use for growing that. We put that chemo on the ground and took it in, and that's good. And this is only anecdotal, but it seems like that having a lot of that chemo in the ground has helped as far as controlling some of the wild pests, like the sweet potato weevil doesn't seem to be as bad. We always have that. That's always an issue, but move our potatoes around a lot to try and avoid that. But the limo has been really good for that. And when we grow taro, we put the limo around, pre-plant, and then the other fertilizer we use is a fish / bone meal from Island Commodities, which is high in nitrogen and phosphorus, but low in potassium. So limo has been a good complement for that. And then recently we've been looking at different ways to deal with this limu, including composting, and I'll let Fred describe that to you.
Yeah, and I've been keeping and we don't get feedback, so hopefully, well, if you guys have questions, maybe we can just do it at the end. I'll share the screen with you so that you can see pictures of our compost piles. Can you see our? So that's what our limu looks like. We have the gorilla ogo. Okay. Oh, okay, great. So yeah, that's what our limu looks like. It's really thick and branching, and that's the Kappa ficus. And we also have the gorilla ogo, which is more thin. But I think most of what we get is this Kappa ficus. Oh, that's grassulet? Okay. Well, I guess we get a lot of grassulet. Yeah. Anyway, it looks like that. So yeah, these species were intentionally introduced. They were supposed to start a carrageenan industry with food additive. And they introduced them to Coconut Island. And they escaped. So anyway, I'll show you the piles. They collected in bags, mesh bags. They need to be emptied out by hand. And then we use a hot tub to build the piles. And these are some piles we made with different ratios, limu to tree trimmer mulch. And here he's mixing the limu with the mulch, covered them with black plastic. Now we're mixing in fish bone meal as well to increase the nitrogen of the pile and get it heating up faster. And we did some monitoring of the temperature of the piles, and this is pretty much normal post behavior, so that was good. But it tapered off fast. Want the temperature to stay high long so that it really breaks down all of the organic matter and it's stable for using yields. So we've been playing around with different ways to efficiently build the piles. This is kind of old. What we're doing now is just laying down a bed of mulch. And then whenever the seaweed crews come in, they just throw the new layer on that bed, and that gets covered with a layer of mulch and fish meal. We keep layering it like that until it's ready to. Yeah, we gotta add water. So we still need to do some work to figure out you know, how to make the ideal compost. And there's so much variability in the quality of mulch that we get. Some of it's really woody, some of it is leafy. So you kind of have to adapt with each batch. And then the biggest thing is we got to create a network of farmers and gardeners who are willing to use this stuff. And the first time we did it, we had about 14 or 15 different farmers from the Kaneohe Bay watershed come by and pick up the finished compost. And they, I think they hauled off about 14 truckloads.
15 farmers and gardeners.
And yeah, some of them were community gardeners, and they came and they just took, you know, a bucket home. But some people got truckloads as well. So right now, we're still doing the compost, and we're also experimenting with a biodigester, which is a way that you can just, we're hoping you can just add straight limu, fresh, to a closed vessel. And what it does is it breaks down inside this box here, and it will produce methane, which you can use for cooking. And it also produces like a liquid fertilizer that you could use as a foliar spray or as a soil drench. But it pretty much retains all of the original nutrients that were in the fresh seaweed. So we built this contraption. It's huge, it's very heavy, and we don't even know if it works yet, but keep posted on that. And then there's some other designs to be tried out for aerobic digesters. That's pretty much all we have. So if there are any questions, we have to answer.
They're also clearing mangroves and Hile there. So she could probably tell you about that. Hopefully to convert that into a truck biochar, use that, charge that up with sewage effluent coming out of the carbon charcoal, very long lasting.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Hey, aloha. Should I repeat that about biochar?
Want me to share the screen again?
Live stream.
Okay, can you hear me?
That's slow.
Hard for me to hear. But we, part of our plan that we have is to work with biochar. And then at Waikaiohia, there are mangroves. And anytime we get big windstorms, a lot of downed trees, we're saving it. And the hope is to build a truck. Convert it into charcoal, which is right up to biochar, which will charge or prime this effluent coming out of the methane digester. And that will turn into slow release fertilizer. We also mix it with the compost that we produce. So this kind of soil is something that not only sequesters carbon, but is a slow release kind of a fertilizer, builds up, improves the tilt of your soil, makes it much more workable, and is part of the package of dealing with that.
So, yeah, that's the thing. We want to do a Q&A. Would that be helpful?
Aloha, how much does the contraption, I walked in kind of late, but how much does that contraption cost to make?
The methane?
Yes.
We don't know. How much do the materials cost, or how much methane does it make?
Oh no, how much does the materials cost?
Materials cost.
Probably around 1,000. You add in all the details and stuff. But we're also looking at a couple other designs that might be considerably cheaper than that. There's a lot of information on the internet about this kind of stuff. They're doing it all over the world. So this one that we built was designed by our brother David, who has his own digester on the Big Island, and he's basically using the horse manure to feed his digester and does all the cooking in his house with that. But he says that the effluent that he gets out of that is that he uses for fertilizing his plants is more valuable even than the methane.
He uses about 1 5-gallon bucket of horse manure a week, and that does all his cooking. Wow. So his is a cement tank built into the ground. Smaller than what we built.
So one of the goals in designing our digester is something that anybody can do. So we made it out of plywood. Figured that's readily available to anybody, but it was more expensive than we thought it was going to be. So it also might be a little bit too heavy duty. Like we could go with a thinner plywood for parts of it. So there's some tweaking we got to do still yet.
And part of the idea of going with the digestive too is that we're hopefully going to end up with a more concentrated form of fertilizer and cut down on spreading costs and things like that, having to, you know, drag all the leaves out on the field and
till it
and do all of that. So this is a way maybe to deal with a much
handling costs.
Yeah, handling costs, reduce the handling costs for the leaves.
There. Charlie, can you hear me, Charlie?
Yeah.
Okay, we're running out of time, but you know, all the stuff that you folks are providing, I had hoped that I had invited Elton Arakaki and also Glenn Tevez. They started a whole new series of generating interest for young Hawaiian homes farmers at Ho'olehua. So that's another area I feel that we wanted to make connection, because I believe that if you're looking at how big that you're using on backhoe for turnda, for huli, the limo, the jai limo, and mixing it with mulch and then adding other amendments, I truly believe that that could be very beneficial here. And we do have a MCC ag farm that we could maybe do a demonstration plot with that type of process you have. And maybe even if it's commercially, potentially, we could bag that up and sell it and you guys can make cost effectiveness. But we need to get these people in agriculture in the same room. Are you folks available? I'm going to push a little harder for Glenn and Elton to make contact with you folks.
Yeah.
Because this communication sucks. We can hardly hear you. You're mumbling. You're kind of going in and out. And I'm telling myself, oh, this is not right. I mean, so the next time we do this, we could only do agriculture. And we're going to do you folks just talking to some young farmers that are part of the classes that Glenn and Elton have done. It's been growing, moving on Molokai. They're planting. Tubbs Kalipi used a special tea to get rid of a blight that was hitting his taro. And he used that as part of a more natural approach. So this is a natural approach that could be very beneficial for our farmers to increase production. We're all about increasing production. So if this is going to work as a soil amendment, we really got to capitalize on this and bring you folks as part of the learning opportunity.
Yeah, the connection between farmers is and all the people involved in agriculture is super important. It's all about, taking proper care of your dirt. And that's the whole issue with large-scale conventional chemical agriculture and GMO and all that stuff. Is the underlying basic problem of all of that is it does not take care of the dirt. So we need to get much more on the same page as far as farmers about, soil health and understanding what soil health is all about, understanding organic matter, all those kinds of things. So one of the things that we're going to do with this project too is later on when we, after we've actually got this digester up and working and when we get our first batch out, then we're going to have workshop here for and bring together a lot of the farmers in our different watersheds and show them the thing and do some demonstration kind of stuff. So we would for sure let you guys know when that's going to happen. And, maybe a couple guys, people from Molokai could come over here and check that out. And then depending on what our results are and what happens, maybe we could come over there and possibly do a workshop on Molokai too, showing what this project is all about. Because and the taking care of the dirt thing is totally connected to the, as you guys know, the taking care of the reefs and that whole ecosystem there. And already, on all the islands, we got so much runoff, so much erosion and stuff going into the ocean that's, that's bad in and of itself besides the invasive lemur. So these projects are all connected.
So Charlie, this is Colette Machado. I'm going to hold you to that, and I'm going to push Elton to make some kind of communications to you folks to put them on the radar screen to include our young farmers here on Molokai.
Yep.
Okay, Hiki. Okay, so Paul and Charlie and Fred, thank you so much. But you cannot substitute the real person, so you guys got to come next time, okay?
Okay.
Okay? Ahoy ho. Here we go, Hi'ile.
Keep doing what you guys are doing. I'm glad you guys got this project happening.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you guys very much.
Hi'ile is really an inspiration for the next generation that can take care of the aina and the ocean. And with her, she includes her father. And also, it's a family event down there at Hi'iakea. I went there many years ago when the pond was run down. And they had, Brooks was over there, her last name was Brooks running them. And when I went there, I couldn't believe it was the same pond. It was like night and day. The mango tree that I used to make reference to was gone. And the pond was just clean to the point where you could actually know that the good work was being done in the local ER. So I looked at her young spirit and with her kupuna behind her, you cannot help but be inspired. So I'm very pleased that Hi'ile could join us this morning on Molokai.
This is where I work. And this photo was taken just a couple of days ago. I figure I might as well take the opportunity to share with you some of the progress to date. So pretty much our fish pond, He'eia Fish Pond is where I work. Our nonprofit organization is Pai Pai o He'eia. And to date, we've restored half of the fish pond wall, which is 3,500 linear feet. And you can see all of the wall that's been restored to date. It's basically the wall that's exposed that doesn't have mangrove growing on it. So we're halfway done. We have another 3,500 feet of mangrove to go, and it continues right around in a full circle. Also pointing out in this picture, it shows basically, I don't know if you can see it, but from my laptop you can see it better, the extent to which invasive algae has become a problem within Kaneohe Bay in my lifetime. I would say really it's become a huge problem in the last 15 to 20 years. And it's basically all of the reef, all of the area on the reef that you see kind of dark in color is pretty much composed of three different invasive species: Gracilaria salicornia, Capophycus, and Acanthophora. And I pronounce things differently because I pronounce it the way it sounds good to me. So just, I'm not proficient in Latin. again, another shot of our fish pond, which is where I work. But you know, for us in the Lokoia, it's all about growing herbivores. Herbivores eat limu, yeah? And so in the case of mullet, the growth stages of mullet are pua'ama, ama'ama, and then anai. There's actually another one between pua'ama and ama'ama, which is called kahaha. This is what mullet eats. It's called microphytobenthos. It's actually a packet full of diatoms. That's their primary food source, and then this is what it looks like up close and personal under a microscope. This is the food for mullet, but at its core, it's limu. Yeah, it's just microscopic limu. And then the other fish pond fish is ava. Yeah, and both of these fish are both herbivores. The growth stages of ava are puava, ava, and then kalamoho is the ava that you see like 30 pounds plus. Their food is ele ele. I think they also eat halafala, which is the seagrass. There's stories in Kaneohe Bay about people catching ava on hook using halafala. But this is actually in our fish pond, Michelle Kapana Baird. You can see ele ele on the island of Oahu. You gotta come to our fish pond though. if you know where to look, you can find it. But ele ele is a biological indicator of the presence of fresh water. So you gotta go where there's vai. And so for us, limu is very important as mahi'a or fish farmers of the traditional Hawaiian aquacultural practice. But growing up as a child, I was very ma'a and accustomed to harvesting native types of limu. So Manuel asked me to talk about eating or invasive algae as ai, and I'm probably like the worst poster child for talking about eating invasive species, because like I have a hard time. I'm just going to be honest with you. But I, you know, grew up harvesting limu kohu, and we have our spots that fortunately today are still present in Kaneohe Bay. Grew up harvesting huluhulu waina. You can't find huluhulu waina within Kaneohe Bay anymore. We have to go outside of Kaneohe Bay to harvest huluhulu waina, or call Wally Ito and he'll get it from the limu tanks at Anuenue Fisheries for us. But this is key ingredient for our ake, so it's a must have. Limu lipoa, there is still ample amounts of lipoa on Oahu. Li pepe or li pu'upu'u, depending on where you're from, you have different names for it. My tutu actually refers to this limu as li pu'upu'u. But we also have certain spots where this still exists. And then manawea. So I wanted to share the story about the last time that I was able to harvest manawea from Kaneohe Bay, and that was at my nephew's first birthday luau. He's now 14, going on 15. There was one spot where we gathered enough manawea for his baby party, and we use it in our opihi. We chop it up with other types of limu in our opihi. 2 years later, for my niece's first birthday luau, we went back to the same spot, and it was gone because it was completely overgrown with Gracilaria salicornia. So growing up, the composition of limu has changed dramatically, but when I was growing up, the big invasive species during that time was Dictyospira cavernosa, which is bubble algae. We hardly see that anymore. It's been replaced by kind of these, the big three, yeah? Capophycus, Gracilaria, salicornia, and Acanthophora. So it's very mina-mina that a limu that we're so ma'a to and growing up to eating doesn't exist anymore within the confines of Kaneohe Bay. This actually was, I saw this 4 years ago outside of our fish pond. It was like one clump of limu, so there's hope. So these are our three different invasives that we have within the fish pond, adjacent to the fish pond, out on our reef Malauka'a, and everywhere within Kaneohe Bay. Pretty much everywhere there's low flow, all three of these species exist. The only places where it's more sparse are areas that receive a lot of wave action or strong currents. So this is Acanthophora. Oh, this is Gorilla Ogo, Acanthophora, and Capophycus. So for us in the pond, you know, it's very much dependent on the restoration efforts of our wall. To date, limu was pretty much just able to go in and out of the fish pond over the wall on a high tide. So we didn't put much effort into large-scale restoration efforts within the fish pond. Our plan is to fully restore the fish pond wall, at least the makai portion of our fish pond wall, so that at least we can keep the reseeding out of the pond, and then maybe apply for a grant in the next 1 to 2 years for large-scale removal effort within the pond. All three species are represented within the pond. And you know, on the island of Oahu, I don't know if it's like Molokai, probably not. Definitely not. We have too many people. But with the too many people and the overpopulation of an island, you got a lot of education that needs to happen, right? And you got a lot of bodies that are willing and hungry to learn about their surroundings and the environment. So we got a lot of guruts. So this is a typical invasive algae removal event. We had some funding from the Nature Conservancy, I think, as well as Harold Kale Castle Foundation, from about 2005 to 2007 to do a lot of community outreach in the way of invasive algae removal. Our method, because there's no coral within the Lokoi'a, is manual. And I tell you right now, the manual method, using your lima, can blow away the super sucker that any day. I challenge you guys. No, I think we have challenged the super sucker in the past. And yeah, you get 100 willing community volunteers out there where there's no coral, because we don't want to damage the coral. And yeah, we, I think on you know, in a given year with four invasive algae removal events, the most limu that we bagged was 30,000 pounds of limu with just four events. And you're talking like, you know, it's a 4-hour event, but by the time you actually get people in the water and in there, you may be working for about 2 hours. So that's you know, you can do some damage. Then Eric Ko is in the audience, and he's the mastermind behind this innovation you see right here. This is the mini sucker. So we know the super sucker was devised by DAR and TNC. This is a mini sucker. It's a diaphragm pump that Eric MacGyvered for us to use on a little Hobie cat in the pond. It worked, but still yet, the manual method using you know, community volunteer, that just was way more efficient than anything you can do mechanically. And then this is the super sucker. So during those community events, the super sucker would come out and it was an opportunity to interact with the community and show them what the state and TNC is doing in the way of removing algae on our patch reefs and fringing reefs within the bay. And then this is just basically, once we fill all the bags, we have to pass all the bags, same like Mauna Lua, to the pickup site, so that the rapoons can load it into their very cool truck. I love this truck, and I hope it's still running. but then it goes up to the farm, and they sometimes have to come back for multiple trips, or sometimes we take our trucks up and help them out. And then this is our limu mulch pile, which was intended to just be used on site at the fish pond for our gardening. But from the fish pond, it goes to the taro patch, or in the fields of the rapoons, and they've used it for uala primarily. I think they've seen the most success with uala, but they've also used it in their corn fields as well as their lo'i. They put the limu in fallow, they leave it in for a couple weeks, and then they stomp it down, and then they flood the lo'i so that all the limu has been broken down and is subsurface in the lepo. And the story that Uncle Charlie tells me is that it's you use it that way, and then you plant your huli into that lepo, and it's really good because I guess potassium is used by the kalo initially when you plant the huli. Like, that's where it needs to use potassium to kind of generate that strength to put the first roots down from the huli. And then for us, because we're a nonprofit and we rely heavily on grant funding, which is not a very good model to follow as far as nonprofit goes, or so they say. we try to think of different ways to generate revenue for the organization. And we still have vendors. We pick the invasive Gracilaria salicornia. We clean it, which is very labor intensive. And then we sell it to different places. So currently our vendors include Whole Foods, Hula Grill Waikiki, and Mark Noguchi, who is a chef. But there was 1 year from 2007 to 2008 where we had one vendor that was buying 200 pounds of limu from us a week. And in that year, we generated $32,000 in revenue off of invasive limu. And the price ranges between, depending on how well we have to clean it for the vendor, ranges between $2 a pound and $4 a pound, which is crazy if you think about it, because how much do our taro farmers make for their kalo per pound? 50 cents to a dollar a pound. So we're getting $2 to $4 for an invasive species, and I mean, there's no, like, you don't have to put any love into it, right? It's just, you just go out, harvest them, come back in and clean them. and then there's our limu salad. So I've made this limu salad too many times, and I'm tired of making it, but people really like it. Back in the day when I first started volunteering at the pond, there was a vendor. We used to have two vendors, Haile's Hawaiian Foods and Kalihi Super Meats. Kalihi Super Meats is run by, I think, Filipino family, and so they had this awesome recipe for their limu salad. We tried our best to get close to it. We got pretty close, but it's still not as good as the one they used to make. But this is the recipe for our limu salad, and it's changed over the years. We no longer use apple cider vinegar. We use white vinegar. We use lime in it. We grate ginger in it. But yeah, you know, anything tastes good with shoyu, vinegar, tomato, and onion. And this is it. And we were actually selling this at Farmer's Market once a week in Windward Mall for a year. And then we discontinued that. But this is some other creations that chefs make. This one actually incorporates Samoan crab meat into it in place of the dried opai or the cuttlefish. But that's pretty much it. Mahalo.
We're very proud to showcase two of our young students. One is just finished the sophomore year at the high school, who will be going on to her junior year. And the other sister just graduated, and she has been accepted to go to Duke University. I was part of a presentation some months back about, we not only had the mangrove girls, but we also had the agar extraction girls, and we had hoped they could join us today, but being summer and other activities, they could not commit. But we are very pleased to share with you the talents and the, you know, it's beyond just them being bright. They really love this island. And, you know, when we talk so often about being homegrown, I'm really proud to introduce Sarah and Lily Jenkins.
Aloha, everybody. Like Auntie Colette mentioned, I'm Sarah Jenkins, and this is my younger sister, Lily. On your program, it only says that I'm talking, but Lily was able to come today. So we just want to kind of talk about our project. Although it's not specifically on Gorilla Ogo, it has a direct relationship to Gorilla Ogo. Gorilla Ogo actually has a symbiotic relationship with mangrove, which is the topic of our study, and it actually grows three times more in mangrove-infested areas than it does in the open ocean. And this is what we think is because, like they mentioned in previous studies, Gorilla Ogo isn't found as much in like high tidal inundation environments. So when there's a lot of tides and a lot of wave action, and in mangrove, it basically provides a perfect harbor for Gorilla Ogo to grow. So we're gonna talk a little bit about our project, but before we go into it, I just wanna mention, this is like mangrove keikis. I just wanna mention how passionate we are about this. Again, it's not just a project for us. We grew up in these environments, in the fish ponds, physically seeing in our lifetime this change and how big of a problem it's become. So we just want to, hopefully our passion shows in this project, and we really want to create a difference. So any type of community feedback we get from you guys today would be very helpful in our next steps. Our project is called March of the Molokai Mangroves, and it's a study on the socioeconomic and ecological impacts of introduced red mangrove on the Hawaiian Islands. So in case you don't know what mangrove is, it's a salt-tolerant plant native to many places around the world, most likely known to be native to places like Florida, where it protects their ecosystem. However, in Hawaii, it has a very detrimental impact on our environment. It's able to survive through our harsh environments, like high salinity levels, high wave action, and it's actually able to change salinity. So what we found in just our baseline data is that it's risen salinity levels, it's risen turbidity levels, and it's lowered dissolved oxygen levels. So at a very small level, we really realized how big of a problem this was, but we wanted to take this to the next step and physically map how big of an impact it's having on our island.
So a little background information on Gorilla Ogo. It was first introduced in 1902. So in 1902, mangrove was first introduced to the Pala'au region of Molokai by George Monroe, who was the manager of the Molokai Ranch. And the purpose for its introduction was to help mitigate and control the mud deposition and coastal erosion that was caused by the free-ranging feral domesticated ungulates on the island. The problem with mangrove is that, especially through our lifetime, we've noticed it's beginning to colonize very valuable areas along our south shore, including coastal wetlands, shallow bodies of water, our fringing reef, as well as tidal mudflats. And mangrove also has the ability to turn open ocean into dry land. So this poses an irreversible effect as we know it, because once that dry land is created, we can't convert it back into ocean. So our study explores a twofold question. One, does mangrove have the ability to reach our fringing reef? And if so, how long will it take to cultivate an established population, which is basically the progradation rate or seaward expansion rate in mangrove? And two, what are the impending socioeconomic and ecological effects of mangrove on our island?
So with our initial questions, we had to develop our own hypothesis because this study has never been done before. We were kind of on our own in the way that we implemented our action to actually see how big of an impact it's having on our island. So we hypothesized that geographic information systems, also known as GIS technology, would be allow us to map the extent to which mangrove cultivates our island. And then after that, we use benthic habitat modeling to see what it's gonna reach in the future. So the maximum impact it could have on our fringing reef. And then we also collected surveys. So we surveyed our residents, we surveyed our local fishermen, people who participate in ocean recreational activities like paddling, surfing, and also our tourists to really gauge a dollar value on our coastal ecosystem, because we really want to develop a management plan. And in order to do that, you need to see how it's impacting the ecosystem and how it's going to impact people personally in terms of revenue.
So what is GIS? GIS is a geographic information system that allows one to map inquiry models or data and convert it into an image that will be projected to to audiences like you or the community or just people themselves. And it provides the power to create maps. So it's a series of imagery. So you have elevation, transportation, address, boundaries, water features, survey control, and then your data projected onto that. So our data collection began with investigating the causes of upslope erosion connected from Mauka to Makai. So in 1778, Captain Cook introduced European and domestic pigs and goats. And I believe there's a kapu placed on them that you couldn't, like, I believe, hunting and a lot of recreational uses for them. And so the feral ungulates basically grazed our island down to a dust bowl. Right here, we're just going to show some historical pictures. So before we even did our project, we really wanted to gain a lot of Manawa and as much information as we could on the history of our ecosystem and how this has become a big problem and how we're relating it to present day times. So these pictures are just pictures historically of our ecosystems. In the picture on the picture that like kind of shows the mountain, that just shows how our island was basically grazed down to a dust bowl. And then the other pictures show that you can actually see the south shore. That's actually the old wharf. And as you can see, there's no mangrove there. So people who are familiar with our wharf today, there's mangrove everywhere. So that's just kind of a historical image that we use to kind of get a glimpse of what these ecosystems used to be like. And this is, again, another picture of the wharf. So we're just going to skip through those so you guys can kind of see historically what it used to look like. This is a picture of Annie Alexander. She actually came in the 1900s to actually collect bristle-thighed curlews, or the kiowea, which is our official bird of Kona Kakai. So it showed how, like, even in these times that these birds and all of these native organisms were in these habitats, and now basically you rarely find them because of the amount of impact that mangrove has had on these ecosystems. This is looking east where the sun rises, so you can see that you can see the whole south shore. Again, it's just imagery, historical imagery to show you how big of an impact it's having now. You really can't see this type of viewpoint because of mangroves infestation along our south shore. These are historical maps that we use for our project. So to determine the progradation rate or seaward expansion of mangrove, we had to register and look at maps dating back during the introduction of mangrove as well as throughout the years from its expansion. So again, we registered these maps and we created an artificial shoreline from them. And the maps that we conducted and used in our survey to determine the progradation rate were from 1915, 1922, 1941, 1961, 1977, 2000, and today. And this is supposed to be an animation to show the progradation rate, but it's not working. So this is just what you would see if that animation worked. And each color represents a certain area. So for example, the purple is from 1915 to 1922. And from this and all of our registering maps on our ArcGIS software, we were able to determine that mangrove has expanded 1,800 meters outwards to our fringing reef, which is already two-thirds of its way to establishing itself on the US's largest fringing reef, as well as the world's third largest fringing reef. And connecting the two, so we also mapped all the fish ponds dating back to the early 1900s, pre-introduction of mangrove. And the reason we did this was because throughout our research, we noticed that mangrove has begun to establish itself on top of areas that there are fish ponds, and that's where they're most relevant. So we mapped and determined that there are over 650 hectares of fish pond area, and over 66% of that is now taken over by mangrove. So we only have about 34% of fish pond area left because of mangrove's colonization in these areas. And we also did a process called benthic analysis, which is basically the depth measurements from a tide mark to the seafloor. And basically what this is we averaged over a tidal or a year's worth of tidal data from NOAA, and we also found out that mangrove has the ability to grow half a meter below that low tide mark. So we determined that the average tide mark was zero, which makes sense because we have minus tides on the island. And from there we inputted an equation into the software, and we calculated the whole like full extent that mangrove has the ability to populate itself. And so the pink that you guys see on the screen represents everywhere that mangrove has the potential to grow, and red is where the mangrove is currently now. So if you guys can't see, I mean, you can come up later or we can share this about you, but this takes over about 64% of our reef on Molokai, which is a very huge impact. And from our progradation rate, we were able to determine that this will happen within the next century if we don't do anything about it. So again, this is a up-close imagery. It's Hikauhi to Pala'au is the first slide on the upper left, and the Pala'au to Makokupaya, and then Makokupaya to Kamalo, and then Kamalo to Kumimi. And again, this is just a devastating impact to our resources because our fringing reef, again, is the largest in the U.S., and it's a very large subsistence role to our economy. Mangrove will not only reach our fringing reef, but it will also destroy it within a century.
The reason why we have this slide on here is because when we've done various community presentations, one of the main things that our community members bring up to us is, if there's no more mangrove, where is all our mud crabs gonna go? And so we just wanna share with you that mangrove is actually a harbor for many invasive organisms. And like we mentioned before, it changes the water quality, it changes the physical characteristics of these ecosystems. So it actually blocks out a lot of the normal estuaries and things that these mud crabs and our other like opi and our fish would have to grow, and so it actually makes them have less of a population. There's different mo'olelo from like Mary Kavenapukui, where she talks about how people used to go out and they used to kick like the mud flats, and they used to see all of the fish and all the crabs run up, and now it's really hard to access these areas, and there's actually a lot less mud crabs. So we want to tell you that if mangrove is gone, the mud crabs won't be gone. They'll actually start to reestablish their population. But overall, we, even though this conference is mainly talking about invasive limu, we did want to share with you that it is talking about the eyes of the reef, and this is an upcoming and it's always been a historical problem on our island. So we just really wanted to share with you our own individual research of what we found of how mangroves impacting our island and what we're going to do to move forward. So eventually, or right now, what we're working on is trying to develop a management plan. So working with our community and different stakeholders to try to figure out what we can do, and blocking off a specific target area where we can test the different methods of removal and see what's the most effective. But overall, we really do want to remove mangrove, and we do want to connect it to how Gorilla Ogo grows 3 times more in mangrove-infested environments. So it's not just one invasive species. It's a bunch of different invasive species that are all thriving and working together to basically march out to our fringing reef and basically taking over our fringing reef. So what mangrove does, it not only destabilizes the coral heads, like it dislodges coral heads, but because it accumulates sediment just like many invasive limus do, it basically changes the water quality, there's not enough sunlight, and it also suffocates our reef. So looking at these problems and trying to work with everybody who's trying to like take all these different things. And I know in previous presentations they mentioned that they're using it for biochar, which is something that we're actually looking at in our management plan. So starting these discussions now would be really good, and there are a lot more discussions happening on mangrove. So we're really excited to share our project with you today, and we're continuing our project throughout this summer and hopefully try to expand it and develop some type of management plan before it gets to our fringing reef.
So we're going to be having 6 community talks throughout the summer, so that information will be provided later. But if you bring your friends and family, it will be really much appreciated. We're going to be doing surveys that will contribute to how this management plan is going to be laid out, and like in addition to going out and surveying a lot of businesses who utilize this valuable resource. And message to the audience, don't kill breeders such as these for the mud crabs? And what's next? So experimental mangrove removal project to explore the potential for future large-scale mangrove eradication that incorporates the removal of Gorilla Ogo. And we will be able to identify the areas and develop protocols for mangrove and Gorilla Ogo removal, calculate the area of infestations in each Ahupua'a system, and calculate the areas of infested individual properties, so like all the tax map keys. And this will all be utilized and researched and completed throughout the GIS software, and identifying areas for commercial wood stock and potential monetary value. So really turning this management plan and trying to create jobs for the community for an economic base, because with this we really want to give back and we want to provide that support for our community as well, and author the island-wide Molokai Mangrove Management Plan. And thank you.
We want to introduce my mom for helping us, and Arleon Dimon Young, who's our mentor, who allowed us to use her monitors to do a lot of our high mapping software, because it's not something that we can normally do on our normal computers. It's really high, big technology, and so we just want to recognize them for helping us throughout our project and for allowing us to get this far. The two projects that we mentioned earlier with Alex, Kia'a, and Momi, they placed fourth place in the world for their category of biochemistry for their Gorilla Ogo project, and and then Lily and I placed first place in the world for our category of earth and environmental science. So we just want to thank the community for investing in us and and allowing us to continue our research.
I'm going to turn this quickly to Kua. I'm going to introduce Uncle Wally. You can make them short, because you get the other guys who talk to you.
Okay. Oh, good. I'm glad you told me I can make it short, because when I talked to you last week, I asked you, what do you want me to do over here? He told me, oh, no need to do nothing, just come and watch. And then I come over here, I got to talk. So if my talk seems kind of helter-skelter, that's the reason why. But before I go on, I want to make sure that I acknowledge Colette. You know, I don't want to miss this part, because no, because you know, all of this effort, this started a couple months ago, and you know, I got this April 20. Oh, was that long ago? Oh, no, conference call. When was that first conference call? That was a while ago. I get this email, okay, conference call with all of these partners over here, yeah? And you know, my name was included in this email, so I said, oh, okay, you know, I'll call in. And then come to find out that, you know, she wanted to spearhead this effort on removing the Gorilla Ogo on the Molokai shoreline. And when I found that out, I was thinking, holy moly, you know what you're getting into? But during a conference call, it was so good, yeah? All of these partners called in, and all of these partners said, yeah, we're willing to help, and we can do this, and we can do that. And then, so, you know, after that call, I said, hey, you know, this actually might take off. This actually might work. So everybody hangs up, and then she calls me on my cell phone. Oh, Wally, what did I get myself into? But, you know, so I want to... You know, all of this wouldn't have happened without Colette. She's putting all of this together. She got all these partners together. Okay, so thank you. I want to make sure that we thank you for that. I work for Kua, Aina, Ulu, Awamo, and then you want to talk?
Okay. No, I'll just do that general introduction, because Wally has a lot he can say about Limu. But Kua, we use Kua as an acronym. Basically, we try to support grassroots, community-based projects. The organization has a long history of supporting a network of community organizations called Eyalupu, and that consists of farmers, fishers, just like general all kinds of Malama Aina groups. I'm really fortunate to be able to coordinate a network of Lokoi'a practitioners and supporters, so I'm really fortunate to focus on like the fish pond groups. And Wally has the great pleasure. He really loves what he does. He coordinates a new network of folks who are really passionate about restoring native limu and addressing the problems with invasive limu. So, is that good?
Okay. In addition to Kua, I also work with Uncle Henry Changwo with the Eva Limu Project. And our purpose is to do limu outreach, educational outreach. So what we see happening is we're losing a lot of the knowledge that Native Hawaiians used to have about limu. Not only the types of limu that used to be eaten, but Native Hawaiians were even to today, with they make the most use of all the different kinds of limu out of any culture throughout the world. So, but what's happening is we're losing all of that cultural knowledge. And so part of the, our work, myself and Uncle Henry, and also wanna acknowledge Pam and Dennis and Michelle, and of course, Kua and Hile and Pai Pai, they've been very supportive of our efforts to capture that knowledge so we don't lose it, capture and record it. And that's why we had, last September, we had the very first limu gathering. And this limu gathering was about a little over 25 traditional limu practitioners throughout the state. And we got these, we got these people all together who all had knowledge about limu, and they were so willing to share what they had, what they knew, not only with each other, but they were also willing to be recorded. We put mics on them, and then Leimana and Colette participated in that. And so that generated so much interest that created my job with Kua. So this coming October, we're gonna have our second limu gathering, and it's gonna be over here on Molokai. So we're gonna do the same thing. We're gonna bring limu practitioners throughout the state, and we're gonna take advantage of the limu practitioners on Molokai to come and share with us. But going back to our subject about the Gorilla Ogo, what Uncle Henry and I also do is we grow limu. We have fortunate enough to have access to an aquaculture research facility on Sand Island. It's the Delinar Dar Anuinui Fisheries Research Center. So we're growing three native species of limu right now. We're growing the ogo, or the Gracilaria parvispora. The original stock of our ogo actually came here from Molokai. I don't see Steve Chaikin. I don't know if you guys know Steve Chaikin, Molokai Shrimp Farms, but he was very generous in providing us the original stock, and we kind of, we kept screwing up, so we call him up, hey, Steve, we need some more, and so he would, he would send them over to the point where I haven't seen him in maybe a couple years, because we've gotten to the point where we can, we can keep our stock going, and so we don't have to humbug him anymore, thanks to him, he started us off, and we learned a lot about the ogo. Another species we're growing is, as Hile mentioned earlier, the hula hula vaina. I like to use the old name for hula hula vaina is Pakelea va'a. And as Michelle mentioned earlier, Pakelea va'a was Liliu Kalani's favorite limu. She ended up living on the Waikiki shoreline that never have the Pakelea va'a there. They had that brought in from Maui, planted in front of her hale on the Waikiki shoreline. And again, Michelle also mentioned that she showed a picture of an ad in a Hawaiian newspaper, and Liliu Kalani took out an ad asking people to, telling people what she wanted to do in an area to please leave our limu, the pakele of our alone. I want to mention that Uncle Henry, stop me when I can go on and on. Still stop me when, now. Okay, one more story. Uncle Henry has a area on the Ever shoreline that designated a no pick zone, and I met Uncle Henry kind of like right around the time that he started this. And so the first time I got to that area was about 2 years into this no pick status. And what I saw was, what he described to me was Gorilla Ogo just covered the shoreline. And he had the Campbell High School kids come in and take out the Gorilla Ogo. And so 2 years after that removal, what I saw was all of our native limu started to come back, to the point where, you know, you can see a little bit still to today, this is almost nine years later, you still see a little bit of the Gorilla Ogo, but it's still dominated by all of our native limu. So, you know, that's just kind of encouragement that, you know, stuff like this works. If we can remove the invasives and give our native limu a chance, this kind of stuff works. Okay. Hello. Thank you.
Earlier last week, I wanted to introduce, is Daviana here or did she leave? I've been consulting with Rosie Oligato, and she's a PhD, Dr. Rosie Oligato. And then she had prepared for me best practice approach when we did begin the removal. And when I consulted with her last week to ask her if she would be available to attend this session, she said, oh no, Auntie, we're gonna take our summer break and we're gonna join her husband, which is Raymond in San Francisco. So she encouraged me to contact Dr. Celia Smith. She told me, this is the number, this is her email, call her, Auntie. So I called her, and this is just happening like Monday, Tuesday last week. So I call Celia, and I write to her, email her, and bingo, she responds. She says, Colette, in an email, she's introducing me to a graduate student by the name of Sarah Vaz Gonzalez, and she's already asking me if Sarah would be a good replacement on the panel. So of course I go by fate, right? And I'm communicating with Sarah. I find out that, I said, we can pay your airfare. She said, oh, I'm gonna be here already. I'm coming Thursday. Bingo. And I'm gonna turn this, so who let go first? Okay, well, this is Sarah Vaz Gonzalez, one Portuguese like my shadow.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Sarah Maile Vasconcelos, and I'm a recent grad of Dr. Celia Smith from UH Manoa, her lab, which we lovingly call the Limu Lab now. And we have been active in Waikiki for about 13 years now, going on 14 years, where Dr. Celia Smith started the project of removing Gorilla Ogo and Acanthophora specifera from that area. Recently, we've actually seen changes in the reef, and we have mudweed now. So we have a lot less Gracilaria salicornia. We have a lot more mudweed. We have some flip-flops between Gracilaria salicornia and Acanthophora, depending on the time of the year. But right now, we are dealing with mudweed, and it's not in the same type of ecosystem that you folks have here. Outside of Waikiki, right in front of the aquarium, is a no-take zone, and it is all reef. So it's all rocky substrate, except for the channel that's about 20 feet deep, in which Gracilaria salicornia does survive in those large tumbleweeds down in about 15 feet of water. So it can survive in deeper depths. It does survive on the reef in wave zones, because this is Waikiki, right in front of the natatorium, where waves do break. And that's where the focus of my study was, and most of my lab focuses their work outside of there as well, because we have funding from there. Now in Waikiki, it's our center for tourism in Hawaii, so restoring the reef out there is a main concern. It's also the starting point, one of the starting points for Gracilaria salicornia in the state. So it was brought to Waikiki for aquaculture back in the late 60s. Back in 1969, I believe, by Dr. Maxwell Doty. So we use it as our hotspot. And in Waikiki, prior to the Gracilaria salicornia introduction, there was documented over 80 species of native limu. That was documented by Dr. Max Doty and some of his graduate students just before the introduction of the gorilla ogo. And now if you go out there and you swim around, which I've done a lot in the last 5 years or so, you only see maybe a dozen different native species, and they are not in high abundance. But we have seen a comeback of the species that I worked with, and that's Sargassum polyphyllum, or what we call limukala. So there's three different species of sargassum, all referred to as limukala, and I work specifically with the one that you folks see up on the screen, and that's Sargassum polyphyllum. But you can find all three species on all islands. Here, I know that you folks probably see aquifolium a little bit. I'll have a couple more pictures of that later on for you folks. I borrowed this picture from a friend. This is aquifolium up in front of you folks. Now today I want to talk a little bit about some of our restoration methods, our assessments that we're doing. You folks will hear a little bit more about this later on. We took some of our stuff from DAR and we modified it a little bit with different methods that have been used to fit our purposes. And everything that we're going to show you today can be done with mask and snorkel and can be taught to anybody in about 15 minutes. And it's very effective, it can be used for long term, and it's very good to gain an initial assessment where you would set your baseline. And you can compare it to any historical stories, anything of which what you folks knew was there prior to the sight or the seeing of Gracilaria salicornia on your reefs. And then you can use this over the next decade, even longer, to monitor constantly and consistently to gain a better perspective of the work that's being done and where you folks have gone. Okay, so I'm going to talk first about the easy and effective initial assessments. Then we're going to talk a little about education and community, just a little. Auntie Pam and Auntie Michelle already went over this. We do work very closely with Auntie Pam and Auntie Michelle. We've been to Roosevelt, Kaiser High Schools. I've been to many elementary schools as well. And we've talked a lot about this, and community and education is the foundation, especially for our lab. And then a multi-tiered approach to restoration, not only manual removal, but we are working on efforts to outplant urchins, outplant native limu, and we're also working on outplanting or restoring native fish that will focus their eating efforts on the invasive species. Okay, so first, this is something that I did extensively. I designed transects, 10 meters can be different lengths, 50 meters, 25 meters, and all I did was I took a quadra, which you see in the upper right-hand corner, and I put it together all by myself, and I strung it with fishing line. So it's double-stranded, and then I would just go and pick points along inside that quadrat and then note underwater what species was there. So this was an initial assessment to get the benthic cover, what species were present, and their density. So if I did this, I did this for six different quadrats, and we figured out, of course, that Gracilaria salicornia was very, very high density, is the most dominant species out there, but we also saw a lot of acanthophora, and then several natives. So it's a good way to find exactly what you have out there. Very, very easy to use, and you can use it to snorkel, especially out here on your folks' reefs where it's very shallow. And then a fellow lab mate of mine, Dr. Dan Amato, who just recently received his PhD, he modified the old cramp method that was used for scuba diving, and he made it so that way you can use it snorkeling. And it's very similar to what I just talked about, except for it's a little bit more specific in its methods. And it involves two snorkelers, so a snorkeler pair, and multiple 10-meter transects. He did five, which run parallel to the shore. And one snorkeler would take pictures, so a photo quadrat. All that is a quadrat I showed you folks earlier with a camera mounted just above it, so it would frame the picture. The picture would frame the quadrat, and then from there, those pictures would be analyzed using software called PhotoGrid. And from there, you could take what species are there, their cover. This could also talk about coral, and you could use it for almost anything. And then the second snorkel will collect samples of macroalgae, because out in the water, although, like for instance, I'm really good with touch, I can usually touch a limu and understand and know exactly what it is. That might not be effective for those who haven't been trained. So picking a sample and bringing it back to the lab to then analyze it later on to get a better idea of what's out there is always a good example. So the second snorkeler would be doing that. They would be sampling for the actual species. Now a third assessment that we also use is GPS mapping, and I use the decor brought from DAR. DAR came in and taught our lab how to basically do a real quick assessment in which we swim around with mask and snorkel once again with a GPS, a waterproof GPS. And every time we see a species of interest, in this case, this is a Limukala map from Waikiki that I did a couple of years ago. You could do it for anything. So for grass Larius alicornia, gorilla ogo, for instance. And every time you see it, you would do a quick assessment for a specific size, and then you would decide if it was dominant, abundant, common, occasional, or rare. And then you would just take note of it real fast and then keep swimming along. And then you folks would decide how often you would take GPS points. All of this is very, very easy. It can be done so quickly. This is just Google Maps up here. I can do this in about an hour. And I mean, there's much better software like ArcGIS that you can use as well. So this is just something that's real easy to use, and it's very good comparison for later on if you folks would like. All of this data can be used to make these 3D types of maps over the depth or over a certain amount of time and along the reef, starting from the coastline, what species are present, and their seasonal variability. So Limukala, for instance, which is what I worked with, is a very seasonal species. It is in high density in the winter, and then it kind of tapers off, and it kind of disappears during the summer, and then it comes right back up. And it's most fertile during the winter months of November, December, January, and then it kind of ends in February. Okay, so that's just an assessment. Once again, this is some things that can be done very, very easily and quickly. Anybody can do it with a little bit of training. And then education and community, of course, the foundation, the backbone, all of our partnerships, Waikiki Aquarium, Honolulu Zoo. We have NOAA, Auntie Pam. We have Auntie Michelle at Kaiser High School, Roosevelt High School, all of the elementary schools with which we work. Lots and lots of partnerships. Also, DAR and Anuinui Fisheries Research Center, where we have a lot of our, my lab mates are working in some of the mesocosms there and doing some of the work I'm going to show later on in the talk. So thank you very much for all of your partnerships. And education is a keystone. I actually graduated and I became a teacher. I now teach high school. Unfortunately, I can't teach marine biology all day long, which is what I would love to do, but I do teach biology. But teaching them and getting them interested in stuff that is around them, because for our students today, their baseline is not what some of the people here's baseline is. They don't understand that the reef is not what it used to be. So they go there and they're like, oh yeah, that's just invasive algae. That's there, that's all I know. Going back and saying, no, that's not what it was. It was this 20 years ago. It was this 30 years ago before you folks were born. We want to bring that back to them. So getting them interested in what was and what later could be is very, very important. So we hold field trips, we design different survey techniques for them to use, get them interested so that way we could rear up more native scientists and bring them to UH Manoa, for instance, get them active, get them running their own nonprofits to start ground roots efforts, okay, coming from the native children of Hawaii. Okay, now lastly, I want to talk about some of the restoration approaches that our lab has done. Now, we work in a little bit of a different area than you folks have here, but it's still the same species. So it's still gorilla ogo, it's still a big mess where we are in Waikiki. But we take a multi-tiered approach to restoration. So first of all, of course, is volunteer-based invasive algae cleanup. So Dr. Celia Smith couldn't be here today because she is running our largest invasive algae cleanup today in honor of Dr. Abbott. So she's in Waikiki right now with about 100, 150 volunteers removing algae, taking that algae to the Honolulu Zoo in their zoodoo. So they use it as compost. It goes with the elephant dung and it gets taken. People can come and pick it up whenever they want. So that's where we do, that's where we donate all of our, we usually get between 1,000 and 1,500 pounds every crack that we have of volunteer efforts, as long as it's about 50 people or more. We used to give it to the rapoons. I remember hearing stories about 10 years ago, 12 years ago, the rapoons used to come down and pick it up and take it down to Waiahole. And then after the cleanups, they haven't been enough. So we still have a problem in Waikiki. And so we are trying to return natives, lots of different natives, to Waikiki. And we're trying in other areas as well. So I'm gonna let Hoaka talk more about urchins, the collector urchin, after this. And then I will talk briefly about returning native fish, which specific species we've seen that actually eat grass Larius alicornia over native algae. And then the native limu approach as well, my Limukala studies. So we have an undergraduate student, Scott Chulicote, who was working on designing this experiment where he was like, well, you know, we don't have much fish here, but on Oahu, because our ecosystems are so degraded. But if we did, what would they eat? Would they prefer invasive species, or would they prefer native species? So his question was, do native fish have a preference for native or invasive species? Because it makes a difference. We have so much invasive species. It'd be nice if somebody would eat it, right? If somebody would go out all the time and be grazing the invaders. If we had more fish, if we put them on the reef, would they make an impact while we're not there manually removing everything all day long? So he devised a pairwise comparison for native and invasive algae using these algal feeders. Real simple, just some rebar and some rope. And all he did was stick invasive species, and then, so either Gracilaria, Acanthophora, and Avrinvillea. And then he compared it with a comparative native species. And these were done with between Scott and Dr. Smith. And so what he did was he tried to go out on the reef in Oahu and tried to videotape it, take pictures. He scared all the fish. There were very little fish to begin with. So this didn't really pan out as we had expected because of our low density of fish that we have on the reef. But instead, what he did was he took it to the aquarium. So the aquarium has the edge of the reef tank in which they have a lot of all their native species, as if we had a pristine coastal ecosystem, a marine coastal ecosystem on Oahu, right outside of Waikiki. This is what it would look like in terms of fish present. Now, what he did was the same thing. He replicated what he did out in the field, and he did it out in the tank, and he found that there were three species in particular of native fish that are found in the tank that actually preferred Gracilaria salicornia and Acanthophora specifera over the natives. Now, these natives were given, based off of historical documentation, what we felt that they would eat. And they're still experimenting with this. They're using different species. We have permission from the aquarium. He actually does demonstrations every now and then that people will come, and the people at the aquarium will come and watch the fish feed. So here you can see, especially the Maneonel, the selfish tang, really likes Gracilaria salicornia. Okay, now on Oahu, we don't have that many native fish available on our reefs, but if we could restore them to some of their locations, maybe, just maybe, they could actually make a little bit of a dent in our Gracilaria salicornia population that we have there. Same thing could be done here possibly with some of your native fish. I know that a lot of the South Shore is a no-take zone for fishing, so perhaps restoring a couple of these native fish would actually may work. You know, the harm would be that they would just swim away, but there's not really much harm in that. Okay, and then finally, what I worked with when I was getting my master's was restoring Limukala to Waikiki. Now, Limukala is culturally a very significant limu that we have here, is used for Ho'oponopono Laulapa'au, and on Oahu, or especially in Waikiki, it was the most abundant species that we had in Waikiki in an area that held over 80 species of native limu. So we were kind of going off of that. Well, Limukala is there, maybe it'll recruit more natives. Because what happens when you get a bunch of natives together? They recruit more natives, right? Everybody comes and joins the party. So we're hoping that that's exactly what will happen if we reintroduce Limukala to the reef. Okay, so we use simple methods, and I designed this little PVC apparatus that helped to introduce or help to seed substrate. The substrate that I used was limestone tile, but you can use basalt rock or coral, anything that you find, as long as it's clean. Okay. And then what it did was it seeded the eggs and the sperm, okay, into their zygotes and their embryos, and then they then landed on the substrate and they started to grow. So it was our own aquaculture little farm of Limukala that we made to propagate. Okay, so here's what it looks like. On the left is Limukala. This is Sargassum aquifolium, most specifically. And all of those little pokey receptacles, they are fertile, okay, with sperm and egg. And what they'll do is they rain down onto the tile that are down below, okay, on the right-hand side, in a little mesocosm that we have at Anuenue Fisheries Research Center. And they make little Limukala babies. Now, being a perennial species, or excuse me, an annual species, they take forever to grow. So we got to give a lot of love to it. And so what we started doing was playing around the idea of getting rid of the diatoms, because we had a lot of diatom growth in our tanks. We've tried everything. And when I was gone this past year, they were successful in figuring out just how to get rid of the diatoms. So as Hi'ile mentioned earlier, what do the mullet eat? The diatoms. So at Anui Nui, they have a bunch of mullet available, and we put the mullet in with the limukala, and the limukala survived because the mullet ate the diatoms, not the limukala, including limukala this small. This is about just under a centimeter in height. So they take quite a bit. They'll be about this size for about 3 months, and then finally they'll bloom with surge. So we designed a surge tank as well to replicate the intertidal zone with a lot of wave action. And so what I talked about with Uncle Leimana yesterday as we swam around looking at the reef was, you know, if we could seed some of this at Auntie Colette's property, and then you could take it back to the fish pond and put it on the outside and just stick the rocks out there. You could even glue these limestone tiles, they're all natural. They can go right onto the fish pond wall, for instance, and we could see if they could propagate along the wall. And this would recruit, hopefully, more natives, more limu, to combat with the Gracilarius alicornia, more fish, perhaps, which obviously is the goal of the fish pond, to get more fish. So this is some of the stuff that we've been working on. And if you folks need any help, you can always email me. I can give out my email if you folks want. It's sarahv@hawaii.edu, or Dr. Smith as well. But we are very interested in helping you folks out. In fact, we have lots of grad students that will love to come down here and help you folks spearhead, especially the Scott Chulakot, who did the fishing, the work with the fish. He's just about to enter our master's program. So he's ready and willing to help you folks as well. And I might be working on my PhD with the limukala. So if folks have any questions, I could take any questions now. Okay, so I just wanted to let you folks know that the Limu Lab, our approach is ecological. So what we look for is basically the relationships. How can we rebuild these relationships to help the ecosystem perpetuate itself? Instead of just manual removal, we want everything to work together harmoniously, because I can't be out there, Hawaka can't be out there. We all can't be out on the reef picking limu all the time. So if we restore the habitat and the ecological relationships, hopefully the rest will come. That was our goal. I'd like to mahalo everybody for your help, especially Auntie Colette and Uncle Leimana for yesterday. I got a real good tour of the ocean here in Molokai yesterday. So, and the good news is, though, that I did only see the two invaders. I was wondering if there was anything else out there, but I only saw Gorilla Ogo and I only saw Acanthophora so far. So that's good. And you folks, it seems to be manageable. You folks are in a lot better shape than Oahu, especially Waikiki, especially Kaneohe Bay and Manalua Bay. So it's good to see, and I'm glad that all of you folks are here, and I hope you folks can do well. And if you need any help, just let me know. Thank you.
Like Uncle Wally said, in September, I was part of the limo group that went down, and we visited Anui Nui fisheries. It was the first time that I saw a native urchin that they were propagating to be placed in Kaneohe, that they had shown such good success with the removal of the gorilla ogo. And when I found out it was a native species and that it was actually a smaller version, not as spiky as the regular ones that we ma'atu, I said to myself, wow, too good this Hawaiian urchin, how it's really helping us. So the concept that Sarah is saying, when you get more Hawaiians collaborating, then more Hawaiians going to hang out. So I was really impressed, and I'm not sure if this is a picture of it, Huaka. We just kind of grabbed it down. I don't know if this is the one. Okay, good. So I was really excited to know that, you know, Hawaiians had their own species, and now it's being used to come back. It's like you take, to give back life, you bring back the old species to help make the changes you need to improve the condition. So this is Hoaka. It's the first time I met him, and I'm very happy we were able to get you here today. Thank you for coming.
Thank you. So before I start, I just want to say thank you to Auntie Colette. So like she said about Wednesday, I wasn't sure if I would be even coming out here, but she made it happen. So thank you very much. This is actually my first time on Molokai, so I'm very excited to be here. So my name is Hoaka Thomas. I'm an undergraduate in the biology program. In the summer of 2012 and 2013, I conducted two studies which looked at water quality, and I conducted larval assays to determine water quality using those native urchins. So, ideally, healthy reefs have biodiversity. And what I mean by biodiversity, it has a wide variety of marine life, and I just made a very general pyramid of what that would look like. At the top, you have your predators, you have sharks, your pelagic fish like tuna, and below that you have herbivorous grazers like fish and sea urchins, and at the very foundation of a healthy reef ecosystem is algae. And ideally, we would want lots of grazers that continually eat algae. So why do we need them? So limu and grazers grow faster than coral, and if left unchecked, limu can actually smother and kill coral reefs. So we need grazers so corals can survive, and grazers eat native limu, and in the case of this native urchin, it can eat invasive seaweed. And it's also it's also an indicator of overall reef health. So if you have a rich biodiversity, or you have lots of different species, you have healthy reefs. And if you have poor biodiversity, like you have very few species, you have an unbalanced reef. And I think Manuel showed a very good picture of that with an algae-dominated reef just kind of smothering everything. And also they serve as food for predators. So this is the native urchin that we're trying to outplant. The scientific name is Trinuces gratilla. It's commonly referred to as the collector urchin, and its Hawaiian name is Hawaii. It's used by the EPA as a bioindicator, like stuff that I use, to indicate like how clean the water is. And it's also a biocontrol, which means that it's able to eat all kinds of limu and invasive seaweed. So a little bit more about Hawaii. It's very sensitive to water quality changes. And I think Manuel and Hi'ile was talking about that earlier. So things like urbanization, anti-fouling paints, and runoff. Anti-fouling paints you use on the underside of the boat, so you don't have to go out and scrape manually with it. And that was the focus on my 2013 study. I was messing around on Google Maps, and I found that there are a lot of boats in Kaneohe Bay all the time. There are private docks, there are marinas, and there are boats out there doing ecotourism every single day. And so that potentially means that there are anti-fouling agents leaching through the water column affecting these urchins. And what I found is that heavy metals, which is the primary component of these anti-fouling paints, kill urchins very easily. And to give you an idea of what, like, the level that it affects is 1 × 10^-26. That is the level of dilution. That is absurdly small. So to give you an idea of what it means, like heavy metals to water, that's about 1 heavy metal molecule to 10 septillion molecules of water. So 1 septillion is 1,000,000 × 1,000,000 × 1,000,000. And it's that level of sensitivity is why the EPA uses it to determine water quality. And this was taken from my 2013 study, even though it says 2014, which looks at hull fouling paints. And on the very top right, you have the primary components of three different types of paints that I looked at. And then you can see that when you go to your right, is a lower level of dilution, and you have a higher rate of healthy urchins developing, but still, at that very small concentration, you only get about 70% healthy urchins. That's amazing. So also, adult urchins eat a variety of native limu and invasive seaweed, and DAR has an initiative to outplant many urchins. And if you were to put it on a smaller scale, ideally they would want maybe 5 to 7 urchins per meter square. Currently we have maybe one urchin per meter square. So it's really important that we physically plant those. And they're outplanted at about 5 months old, and they're very small. They're about the size of a quarter. This graph comes from Lauren Van Heuklem, who is a graduate student in the Marine Department. The Marine Department, Marine Botany Department, and what she studies is feeding preference of trinustes. And what this graph is showing right now is the feeding preference from the Anuinui bred urchins. And what you can see is that they really prefer Limumanueo, which is the G. cornopifolia, and Acanthophora spicifera. And then these are what the wild urchins prefer. You can see that they prefer a wider, greater variety of them and consume them at a higher level than the AFRC urchins. What this graph really shows is that, you know, it's not that the AFRC urchins aren't eating, it's that they just need time. They need time to grow, they need time to acclimate to their new diet, and they also need time to spawn to make sure that there are future generations of urchins that we're not planting, because ideally we want that to happen. So just the summary, urchins are very sensitive to chemical changes. It can be seen in Kaneohe Bay, where there are few to no urchins that can be seen. Wild urchins eat a wide variety of algae. AFRC urchins prefer Limumanueo and only one other invasive algae. And research is still being conducted to further investigate these preferences. And that's it. I would be more than happy to answer questions.
The panel was just to whet your appetite, because the real training will occur with Darla White. Darla, are you here? Please rise right there. She will be teaching us on what practices that will go into Eyes of the Reef, yeah? So that'll happen after lunch. So we're gonna take a break now.